time. And worthy is your name, Jesus. You deserve the praise. Worthy is your name. And worthy is your name, Jesus.
These things I looked, and behold, a door standing open in heaven. And the first voice which I heard was like a trumpet speaking with me, come up here, and I will show you things that must take place after this. Immediately I was in the spirit. Behold, a throne set in heaven, and one sat on the throne, and he who sat there was like a jasper and a sardius stone in appearance, and there was a rainbow around the throne in appearance like emerald. Around the throne were 24 thrones, and on the thrones I saw 24 elders sitting, clothed in white robes, and they had their crowns of gold on their heads. The four living creatures, each having six wings, were full of eyes around them. And they do not stop saying, holy, holy, Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come. Father, this morning we declare, you are worthy, O Lord, to receive glory and honor and power. For you created all things, and by your will they existed and were created. Father, you are worthy to open the scroll and to open the seals. Let's raise our hand, church, and just worship our God. Worship the mighty one, the most high God, the king of the heavens, the creator of the universe. Open your mouth, and by the fruit of your lip, honor him, O God. Speak in your understanding, and speak in the spirit. Shall we raise our hands and honor our God? We are standing. I want us to pray for those who are sick among us, and we are going to claim divine humility. Divine humility for ourselves. You know, I was thinking, Lord, inoculate me. You know, we are all waiting to be inoculated, but I want God to inoculate me first. Lord, you know, so let's just pray to God. Father, heal us, oh God. Father, speak and we shall be healed. Father, speak and we shall be healed. By the stripes of Jesus, we are healed, and we declare it so. We declare it so, Father. We believe in your word, in your holy written word. We are healed in the name of Jesus. Anyone in our community, a relative, a friend, whoever, everyone is healed in the name of Jesus. By the stripes of Jesus, we are healed. By the stripes of Jesus, we are healed. Our family is healed. By body, soul, and spirit, we are healed. In our bones, Father, as we hear the word, as we take the word in, we are healed in our bones, in Jesus' name, oh God. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. We cover ourselves with the blood of Jesus. Cover ourselves with the blood of Jesus. Father, revive every weary soul. Revive every weary body. Heal our bodies and our bones in the name of Jesus. I declare healing over all of us in Jesus' name. I declare healing and release over everybody watching, hearing us in the name of Jesus. And not only you, but all your family members here and without, far away, everyone is healed in the name of Jesus. Thank you, Father. And Father, as the world talks about vaccination and inoculation, Father, inoculate us with love and passion and hunger for your presence and for your word. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Please have your seat. We have a few announcements. One very important announcement for the week is the prayer and fasting. Are we excited? Yes. Prayer and fasting. We are going to seek and sit at the feet of God in our homes during the day, and in the evenings we are going to gather here from 6 to 6. We are going to fast and we gather here and corporate worship and prayer, going to offer our prayer to the Lord. Do not exempt yourself from it. The Lord is moving and is going to move mightily amongst us. So please do not exempt yourself. It's difficult for you, find a way to do it. Yes, and there will be a Zoom. Those of us who cannot gather after the number 50. Can you imagine all of us here? And then we say, okay, now go home. So what a way to begin the year. That we love the presence of God so much that we have to find somewhere to meet again. Just imagine all of us here gathering on Tuesday. Who is coming on Tuesday? I am motivating you to come. If you have no plans, please make a plan. I want to see more hands. Who is coming for the second time? Yes. Let's gather. In the multitude of the saints, the Lord arises. Please come. Let's hold hands together. No, this is social distancing. But we hold hands in the spirit and bind our hearts together and kneel here to the Lord. The Lord will bless us. We will hold his hands. Thank you, Pastor. Exactly. So let's start on Tuesday. Prepare tomorrow. Prepare tomorrow. Prepare yourself and come on Tuesday. From the morning you are coming, and the evening you show yourself physically. But be on standby for the Zoom address also. This morning we have a special message from our brother Meiring. Meiring, please come and give us the word. As the word comes, we are being healed. As the word comes, you are being healed. Father, your presence, your power, and your glory. Father, give him the utterance to speak to us. We are ready to hear you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you, Ed. Yeah, good morning to everyone. It's really good to be back. Took a bit of a break, but it's so good to be back, you know, to be with family, with our brothers and sisters, it is really good to be back. While we were in worship here this morning, I was standing there by the window and I could just feel this breeze blowing. It's like you can smell the rain. And I felt God speaking to me, saying that this wind that blows carries a promise of rain. We know it's already been raining in Namibia and we want more rain. But it also speaks about rain in the spirit. And I just know that there are some people here, there's some people watching, and it feels like you're in the desert, and when the wind blows, all you see is dust. But hold on to that promise. That wind carries a promise of rain. And we're trusting in 2021, we don't know what this year holds. God knows. He's the one that knows. We should stick close to Him, but I know that there are winds blowing that carry a promise of rain. So, Volker spoke about Christ, the way for 2021 last week, and I wanna just stay there for a while. I think sometimes we move on too quickly, and I believe that this is a word that God wants to establish for this year as a platform from where we launch in our lives, but also as a church. So John 14:6 says, "I am the way, the truth, and the life." Now, whenever Jesus says, "I am," it's very important. It's as if He draws our attention to say there's something important here. Every time He speaks about "I am," He brings more revelation about His identity, His nature, why He came. And in most of them, there's about 7 or 8 times in John where He says, "I am." Most of them speak about where He says that He is God in human form on earth. He is the Messiah. He reveals it to the disciples and those around Him. And this specific time when He says, "I am the way," He speaks about that He is the only way to God the Father. That there's no other way. And this is in contrast, this very statement is in contrast, and it smashes that popular belief that's out there in the world that all religions and all faith end up with God. It absolutely just destroys that. God, Jesus says, "I am the way." So just to backtrack a little bit, we have to understand when we read John 14, before that, Jesus had just almost blown away His disciples with a few things that happened. The one was He washed their feet. They came together and Jesus washed their feet. And then He told one of them that He was going to betray Him. One of them was going to betray Jesus. So it shocked them. The other thing was Jesus told them that He was leaving. He was going to leave them and they could not follow Him where He was going to go. Just think about that. These guys had laid down their lives almost to follow Him. Left everything and followed Jesus for 2 to 3 years. Hang on to every word He said. Watched the miracles happen in front of their eyes. And now this Jesus, who was the solution to the world's problems in that day, suddenly He said, "Now I'm leaving." Can you imagine where they were? And even Peter jumped up and said, "No, but Lord, I lay down my life." And I'm not sure what he was thinking. He might have been thinking, if I lay down my life, Jesus can continue on. But and we can learn from that. I think Peter jumped out of, he maybe had a lot of self-confidence at that point in time. And the thing is, confidence in our own abilities and our own wisdom, that does not impress God. He's not impressed by that. God is so much bigger than our abilities, our wisdom. And most of the time, when we trust, when we have confidence in ourselves, it only ends up in trouble and we end up with egg on our face and all of that. But when we have confidence in Christ and the power of the Holy Spirit, it unlocks that door to God moments. And for 2021, I believe there are moments where God wants to just reach out and do things. But yes, we can imagine just how distressed the disciples were hearing what Jesus said. And He said that there's nothing that they can do about it, But he himself can also not do anything about it because he's doing it in obedience. So later on he explains that this is part of the great plan. But we pick up in John 14 verse 1. If I could just get the phone going. And I guess Jesus might have seen that they were greatly distressed. And he says, do not let your hearts be troubled. Do not let your hearts be troubled. That word troubled speaks about something that takes away the calm. It speaks about something that stirs up emotions in the heart. And what happens when there's a stirring in the heart and the calm is taken away, doubt settles in. Unbelief. And I can just imagine suddenly these disciples are looking at this thing saying, but is he the Messiah? Is this truly the Messiah? And that's the exact thing that Jesus then counters. He says, believe, as you believe in God, believe also in me. As you believe in God, believe also in me. And we also see in John 14, where he speaks about him being in the Father and the Father in him. He says, if you don't believe me on the basis of the works that have been done, and that which you have witnessed. And I just know that this year, as we spoke about God wanting to have these moments where he reaches out and he does something, I believe that eyes will be opened up in this year because of what God's going to do. But why is it that when things turn out different than what we anticipated, that suddenly we doubt? We're journeying with God and suddenly the picture in front of us just looks a little bit different. And now we doubt. We say, oh, Lord, are you even still with me? Is this truly your plan? How can it be? But Jesus explains that's all part of the greater plan. And just in my own words, Jesus comes from verse 2. He says, Ashley, Volker, Karen, each one of us, he comes to us, he says, I know your dad. I know your father. I know him because it's also my father. And he loves you. He loves you so, so, so much. And he's got a great, great, great big house. And there are many rooms. And there's a room for you. And I have to go there to prepare it for you. But I will be back to be with you. And you will know the way. You will know the way. Because you know me. That's just my own version. The MKV. But let's just read. My father's house has many rooms. If that were not so, would I have told you that I am going there to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come back. I take you to be with me that you also may be where I am. You know the way to the place where I am going. And that word rooms, in the New King James, it speaks about mansions. I just love that word mansions. Such a cool word to think about it. A mansion for me there. You know, it's not going to be the bachelor's flat next to the father's house. I'm not going to have to pitch my tent at the back in the backyard. And I'm only allowed in for breakfast because the father only wants to spend an hour a day with me. No, that word room speaks about a dwelling place. It's where we dwell with the father, where we dwell in his presence. Can you just imagine what that would be like? And he wants to spend time with us. He wants to be with us. And that's where we're dwelling with him. See, once we were orphaned, but now we're going to be reunited with the Father. The lost are now found. And when Jesus says he goes to prepare a place, heaven doesn't need any preparation. Heaven was designed perfectly by God. It's perfectly designed. Jesus doesn't need to go and hang curtains or do anything for us. It's perfect as it is. What he needed to go and do, he needed to fetch the key. He needed to go and to fetch the key that unlocks these grand doors in the Father's house for me and you. Just picture those doors, these massive big doors. And as it opens up for us, it's just the glory of God rushing through. But Jesus had to go and fetch that key. That's what he had to do. Because of our sin, we were condemned to be orphans forever. And the only destiny we had was the grave, death, and hell. That was it. Because of my sin, that was what was due me. But at that very moment, Jesus knew what awaited him for our redemption. He had to die a sinner's death and become the perfect atonement for our debt, so you and I could receive a true son's inheritance. A true son's inheritance, where we get to share an inheritance with Christ. But for us to be able to do that, Jesus had to go and fetch that key. He had to die in our place. And now, we have a reason to live. We have hope beyond the grave. That's the words Volker used last week. And hope beyond the grave. Death now only becomes a doorway to the Father. It's not death anymore. It's actually now a door. We can speak about the door. It's not death anymore. The sting is out. Because Jesus had conquered it. Jesus had to go into death to conquer it. When Jesus left to prepare the way, we weren't left to ourselves. He left us a helper in the Holy Spirit. As Jesus left to prepare the way, he left us the Holy Spirit to prepare us to be reunited with the Father. So Jesus went to prepare, but he left the Holy Spirit to prepare us to be reunited with the Father. And it's a continuous process. Every day we walk in it. Every day as we tune in our ears to the Holy Spirit, there's a deeper preparation taking place within us. John 14, verse 15 says, "If you love me, keep my commandments." And Jesus says, "The proof of your love is that you obey my words." It's not only in verbal confession of our faith in Christ, but the proof of your love is that you obey my commandments. So Jesus leaves us with hope in the form of the Holy Spirit, and his hope does not disappoint because the Holy Spirit pours out the love of God in our hearts. Romans 5. The Holy Spirit is hope. And I loved Yahweh's message in December speaking about hope for every month in 2021. 12 months of hope that we have. One of my friends recently brought a message on hope, and it was about hope not only being a defensive weapon. We get so used to using hope sort of as a defensive weapon where we say, but we only can hope now because all else has failed. Now we just have hope. Or hold on to hope. But he said that hope is actually an offensive weapon. Because now I've got this hope within me, the Holy Spirit. Because the door has been opened for me, I can be reunited with the Father. Because now Christ has conquered death, I have hope. There's nothing to fear anymore. I've got this hope. And we carry out that hope. It gives us the momentum for every day to go out into every day and take this hope to the world. It's an offensive weapon to push back darkness. John 14, 17. Well, let's read from 16. "And I will ask the Father, and he will give you another advocate, another helper, to help you and be with you forever. The Spirit of Truth." So the Holy Spirit is also called the Spirit of Truth. And Jesus speaks about himself. He says, "I am the truth." Now that word truth is explained as a reality, something that's a reality, something that is true to fact. It's so true that it's factual. It's a fact. And a while ago, I listened to a message of John Piper where he brought a message on that facts change emotions. And what he said, he had this example of a story. He said, if for instance, I came to Karen and I said, "Karen, I just drove by a terrible accident scene. You know, and our friend Joe, I saw his car there. I saw the number plate and knew it was his car. And I walked there and I even saw his bag on the back of the seat. And I asked the police officer where he is and what happened, because there were a lot of cars. And he said that this person had passed away. Can you imagine how she would feel? A friend that just passed away, she would be sad. Sadness would just overtake her. And it doesn't matter, even if someone comes and tells her, be joyful, it would be hard to be joyful. But if while I'm with her, someone calls, Volker calls, and he says, Karen, don't be sad, be joyful, it's not going to change anything. But if he adds to that, if he says, your friend Joe has not passed away, it might change a little bit. Might be some skepticism there, or just what's going on? You know, frustration of this. Now, once he was dead and now he's alive, but what's going on? But if Volker carries on and he says, I went to the hospital and I saw him. The police officer there made a mistake. He's alive. I sat on the bed with him. He's only broken his arm. I'm going to take a picture of him and send it to you. And 15 seconds after the call, here comes the picture of Joe with a cast on his arm and he's fine. Then suddenly, that sadness changes to joy immediately, because there's facts that changes. The world we live in today bombards us with sort of half-truths and facts that are very blurred. It causes confusion, frustration, anxiety, and ultimately leaves us with troubled hearts. 2020 was a bit of a roller coaster ride, I think, for a lot of people, for myself, for a lot of you, and a lot of other Christians out there, because we've gotten so used to having one foot in the natural kingdom and having one foot in the spiritual kingdom. And these two are drifting apart. And at some stage, I'm going to have to decide, do I believe the facts of the natural kingdom or do I believe the facts of the spiritual kingdom? It's important to know that there's nothing wrong with emotions. God created us with emotions and feelings. We were created in His image. That's how He created us. Emotions were created by God for God. And if we were created to worship Him, to be worshippers of God, those emotions help us to worship God. It's like, say for instance, Karen is sad. I'm using her the whole morning. I want to comfort her when she's sad. And when she's happy, for whatever reason, I want to rejoice with her. I want to take her out for dinner to celebrate whatever she's so happy about. When she's scared, I want to reassure that she is safe. And when she's angry, I want to run away. And not really. I think sometimes she'll wish that I'll just go for a run for an hour or two. But I'm the type of guy, I want to sort it out now. But so much more, God, for us as His children, so much more He wants us, when we sad, to run to Him. When we joyful, to worship Him with all our hearts so that He can share in our joy. So much more, God, does He want to share in our emotions. If you just look at the book of Psalms, it's a whole book written from raw emotions. But it's important, if you look at that book, you'll see that David never allowed his emotions to dictate or form his faith or understanding of God. He never allowed his emotions or tried to use his emotions to manipulate God. He always held God and His Word higher as the ultimate truth over whatever the situation was, whatever he felt, the higher truth. An ultimate truth. So in 2021, we have the same choice as we have every year. Do I allow the natural kingdom to dictate, lead me, establish, and determine my emotional well-being? because I hold on to those facts of the natural kingdom? Or do I fix my feet in the promises and the word of God, holding on to Jesus as the only way, the ultimate truth that supersedes my temporary struggles, circumstances, whatever it is I'm facing? Do I hold on to Jesus as the ultimate truth, His words, His promises? If you want to experience more of the new in this season, we will have to shift our focus from the natural kingdom to the spiritual kingdom. And the enemy, Satan, he also has plans for 2021. And in 2,000 years, those plans haven't changed. He wants to come to steal and kill and destroy, to divide and to conquer. But the thing is, he doesn't pitch up with a balaclava and a shotgun in one hand and a knife in the other. He comes in a very deceiving way. He comes in a nice way so that he can get our attention. That's all he wants. He just wants our attention for a moment. And once he's got it for a moment, distraction starts taking place. He wants to distract us from that which God has placed before us in this year. He comes as a half-truth, which is nothing else than a lie, deceiving us and distracting us from the truth, because it is the truth that sets us free. And Jesus is the truth. Jesus sets us free. And he wants to distract us from that. He wants to turn our attention to the natural kingdom, and as soon as he's got our attention, he wants to distract us from who we are in Christ, distract us from the plans and the new in this season, from our hope. He wants to distract us from where our hope is, and he wants to distract us from where the real battle is, the real battle. And this is a word for us as a church in this season, I believe. The enemy wants to lure us out to fight battles that we're not supposed to fight. Because if he can keep us busy fighting battles that are not the real thing, then he just gets us away from where it really matters. Battles that are fake, that have no purpose, that divide, that steal, and ultimately bring destruction and death in our lives, our families, and even the church. Battles in our workplaces, battles in our families, wherever it might be. It could be something as simple as a taxi driver that cuts in front of me and he doesn't realize, but he just entered World War III. He's oblivious of it. He doesn't know. He drives on. But for the next 5 days, I'm waging war. And because I can't do it with him, I do it with my family. I do it with the people at work and with whoever else. But it's a fake battle, and it's only the enemy who wants to distract us. He wants to distract us from where it really matters. And it's an age-old warfare trick that's been used by many armies. What they would do is they would literally on the front line create a fake army somewhere and place a few soldiers there so that it might seem that there's a big build-up that they will attack there. And the opponents would rush there to go and defend that area, only to leave that which is important defenseless. And then they would go in and they would take that which is important because it's defenseless. Satan knows that you as a son of God, with the power of the Holy Spirit, that you pack a punch, okay? And he wants to neutralize it. But he doesn't want to take you on up front, because he knows that victory belongs to God. So he does it in a very deceiving way. There's a spirit of distraction that tempts us and wants to engage us in unnecessary quarrels. So Satan uses temptation. And you all know the story about David. David knowingly was in the wrong place at the wrong time when he was supposed to be at the front lines of a battle, where he was called as a king to be. He was taking a bit of a rest. And when you are knowingly in the wrong place at the wrong time, temptation finds you. And temptation doesn't always stay temptation doesn't just stay temptation. It very quickly escalates into a battle where we are isolated, defenseless, resulting in us being injured and hurt, and those around us as well. But Satan also uses senseless quarrels. In 1 Samuel 17, verses 26 to 29, we see David before he was king. It says, David asked the men standing near him, "What will be but done for the man who kills this Philistine and removes this disgrace from Israel? Who is this uncircumcised Philistine that he should defy the armies of the living God?" We all know that piece, it's so nice. They repeated to him what they had been saying and told him, "This is what will be done for the man who kills him." But when Eliab, David's older brother, heard him speaking with the men, he burned with anger at him and asked, "Why have you come down here? And with whom do you leave those few sheep in the wilderness?" And this is like a low blow from an older brother. It's like, "Hey, shepherd boy, what are you doing here? Who's watching the sheep?" You know? But David gives a very short answer after, his brother also says, "I know how conceited you are and how wicked your heart is. You came down only to watch the battle." So David replies, he says, "Now, what have I done? Can't I even speak?" It's just a short reply. But David could have engaged his brother in a battle there. He could have engaged him there, and this could have been the battle. And he could have been offended by what his brother said and rushed back home to dad to go and tell on his brother, or just to go back to his sheep. And what would have happened? What would have happened? He would have missed Goliath. He would have missed Goliath. Goliath was his launching platform. It was what he was called to do, but he would have missed it. How easily do we get offended just by some misunderstandings or whatever? We turn around and we rush off somewhere instead of keeping our focus on the main thing. If you want to kill your giants in 2021, ignore the voices of doubt, discouragement, envy. Let's fix our eyes on the way, the truth, and the life, on Jesus. And let's storm the gates of hell for the glory of God in 2021. Nehemiah 6, verses 2 to 5. We find Nehemiah busy completing the wall. And says, "Sanballat and Geshem sent me this message. Come, let us meet together in one of the villages on the plain of Ono. But they were scheming to harm me, so I sent messengers to them with this reply: I am carrying on a great project and cannot go down. Why should the work stop while I leave it and go down to you?" 4 times they sent me this message, and each time I gave them the same answer. So here he is, he's busy with an important project. He says this is an important project. But the enemy knows it, and he wants to distract him. He wants to pull him down into quarrel, into some fight. But he just keeps going, keeps doing what he does. But it could have turned out differently. I don't know about you, but I still need to work on those skills which he had. If someone picks a fight with me, the first time I'll be like, "It's okay, let's leave it." The second time, heats up a bit. By the third time, I'm like, "No, I need to fight get my friends. We're going to sort this out." So he could have left the wall. He could have gone down there with his soldiers to sort this thing out. And it could have ended differently. He could have been injured. He could have died. The wall could have been left unfinished. So it's so easy to get distracted. Let us focus on that which God leads us into in 2021. And whenever something else arises, let us have discernment in the Spirit. I previously said that I believe the season we're in, the new thing that God wants to do, He's holding it very close to His heart. So as He reveals it little by little in this season, let's stick to it. And whenever something else arises, let's just pray and ask the Holy Spirit, give me discernment. What should I do about this? Some things we should just leave and carry on with what God has given us. Stick to what God places before you and ignore the sideshows in the natural kingdom. Don't be distracted by the thrills and temptations of the natural kingdom. 2021, our choice of investment. We have the natural kingdom with the facts and the half-truths that it throws at us. And we've got the spiritual kingdom with the word of God. We've got the promises of God regarding our lives. We've got Christ to hold on to. That's far higher. That is the ultimate truth. It doesn't matter what my circumstances, what my situation is for this year, and I can guarantee you there'll be some things happening in this year like every other year that wants to distract us. But we need to hold on to Christ. Romans 8, verses 5 to 6. The last two scriptures I want to read. It says in verse 5, those who live according to the flesh have their mind set on what the flesh desires, but those who live in accordance with the Spirit have their mind set on what the Spirit desires. The mind governed by the flesh is death, but the mind governed by the Spirit is life and peace. Jesus is life. That is life on the Spirit. Romans 8, 13 to 15 says, for if you live according to the flesh, you will die. But if you live by the Spirit, you put to death the misdeeds of the body. You will live. For those who are led by the Spirit of God are the children of God. The Spirit you receive doesn't make you slaves so that you live in fear again. Rather, the Spirit you received brought about your adoption to sonship. And by Him we cry, Abba, Father. So as we continue on in the Spirit this year, we are no longer orphans anymore. We have already been reunited with the Father. The Spirit reveals to us the nature of God. God's thoughts regarding us. His love towards us. So let's hold on to that. Life is in the Spirit. Death is in the natural. Jesus is everything. He's the oxygen. He's the living waters. He's the bread of life. He gave everything, and therefore He requires everything from us regarding our life that we invested in Him. Jesus is not just the cherry on top anymore. We've gotten so used to always, we do our thing and we just put Jesus in there to make it look good, just to finish it off. But now Jesus needs to become everything. So Christ, the way in 2021, Christ, the truth that shall set me and you free in this season. Hold on to Christ, for He shall set us free. And Christ, the life we were called to live in 2021. All right. So let's close our eyes, if all of you can just stand. Thank you, Lord, that as we stand here this morning, that you remind us that we are not orphans anymore, Lord. But you bought us at a price, and now we are sons of God, co-heirs with Christ, Lord. I pray in this season, Lord, that you will remind us through your Spirit of who we are. Lord, and we pray that whatever happens around us in this year, Lord, whatever happens in the natural, we can't avoid it. We live in this world. We live in the natural, Lord, but our focus has to be in the Spirit, Lord. Lord, we pray and we ask that you will pour out into our lives whatever we need for this year, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you for your love. Thank you for your love, Father, that you've poured out over us, Lord. Lord, we come and we acknowledge that so many times we move in the natural, Lord. We look to the facts that are in the natural, to the half-truths in the natural, Lord, and we hold on to that, and it causes our emotions just to become all stirred up, and And Lord, I pray this morning through your Spirit, Lord, that you would come and you just align our emotions with you, Lord. And Lord, I pray that as we look to you, Lord, we will be established in your truth.